Yeah, good morning students. Myself Dr. Prasanna G. Pada. I welcome you all to this BTU Shikshana program on microwave and antenna. So today we will be discussing about module 3 lecture 6, which is about apertures. So these are the contents. So in today's class we'll be discussing about the effective height, how to calculate the effective height, what are the parameters on which this effective height depends upon. Then we'll slowly move on to the aperture. So aperture is a very important part of an antenna which is contributing for radiation. So it is through this aperture only that your radiations are going out of the antenna or coming into the antenna. So even though there are many electric field lines, but whatever is the aperture of the antenna, so whatever the effective electric field line that your aperture is going to intercept, only that much power is going to be entering into your antenna. So again, there are different types of apertures. You have physical aperture, effective aperture, maximum effective aperture, and we'll try to derive an aperture in terms of the voltage, the power density, and other parameters. So learning objectives, basically here the students will be able to study the aperture concept as applied to antennas, derive an empirical expression for the different types of apertures in terms of the voltage, current, and the impedances. The outcomes, basically here you will be able to analyze put up an antenna, model an antenna, by you are going to find out the expression for the voltage induced, the apertures, and you are going to express this apertures in terms of the parameters of the antenna, which is the antenna impedances, then your current and all those things. So finally we will derive an empirical expression for the different types of apertures in terms of the resistances and power densities. Effective height. Now let us say effective height is the ratio of the voltage induced to the incident electric field. So that is how you are defining an effective height. Again, we will try to explain this concept by taking an example. So now let us say you have a antenna, linear lambda by 2 antenna, which is going to be placed coincident with the z axis. Again, this is your current distribution. So this antenna is placed coincident with the z axis, and you can see that the current is maximum at the center. So the value of the current is approximately equal to I naught, and the average value of the current is I average, which is written here 0.64. So this is the total. So this is for distribution. You can see here, this is the electric field lines vertically polarized. Okay, when such electric field lines impinge onto the linear lambda by 2 antenna, there is a voltage which is going to be set up inside this antenna. Okay, there is a voltage which is going to be set up, and because of this voltage there is a current distribution which is going to be set up. Now the effect, the height of the antenna is given by H, which is equal to the ratio of the voltage induced to incident electric field, where H is the effective height, V represents the voltage induced, E represents the incident electric field. Now if you look at this figure once again, so you can understand that even though the antenna length is equal to L, but the current is maximum at this point and minimum or zero near the ends. So in that case, we are going to consider the effective height is as only that portion of the antenna which is effectively radiating or receiving the power. So if you look at this point, so this is your effective height. It is approximately equal to 0.64 times your length of the antenna. Portion of the antenna is basically going for so that is why it is called effective height. So for this particular case, we will try to derive an expression for the effective height for this particular example. So this is the example for a triangular current distribution wherein the current is maximum at the center and zero near the ends, and it is following a triangular shape. So again, here length of the antenna is assumed to be equal to 0.1 lambda. So now you can see here, so effective height is given by HE, which is equal to 1 by I naught integral 0 to HP I of z dz, okay, where I naught is the peak current, okay, which is at the center of the antenna, happens from here to here. This is your I naught value. Okay, and this is equal to 1. Okay, then this is your I average curve, okay, which is equal to 0.64. So effective height is going to be integrating the, okay, integrating, this is your current element dz. So this is your current element dz. This current element is going to have a different value of the current. Okay, so this is your dz. I am going to say this dz is going to have a current equal to I of z. Okay, this is I of z, because the current at on along the length is, let's look at the dz, the current is zero. Again, slightly if I move this dz along the z axis, you see that the current value goes on increasing. If my dz point is at the center, you see current will be maximum. So to find out the total length of the antenna, what I should do is I have to find out the current contribution to the differential current. That means that if I sum up all the currents, all the differential currents acting on this differential element dz over the entire length, which is equal to hp. This is your hp. Okay, and this is your coordinate system. Call it as x, y, and z. Integrate this current from 0 to hp. Okay, I have to integrate this current from 0 to hp. I of z dz. So I of z is the current, dz is the differential element. So 1 by I naught is the peak current. So I am dividing this with the peak current. So the, when you integrate this, it becomes equal to I average by I naught into hp, because integration to z, it becomes equal to I average, which is given here. So in this case, I average value is approximately equal to 0.64 times I naught. Okay, so I naught is equal to 1, so I average is equal to 0.64 times I naught divided by I naught. So I naught gets cancelled. So this will be into HP. So your effective height is equal to 0.64 times HP. This is your HE. Where HE represents the effective height, HP represents the physical height, I average represents the average current, I naught represents the peak current. Now let us now look into the aperture concept. Okay, to understand the aperture concept, let us consider a horn antenna which is going to be immersed in the field of a electromagnetic wave. So we are assuming that the electromagnetic wave is coming along this direction and it is vertically polarized. Okay, and can understand that S represents the power density, okay, which is written in watts per meter square. Okay, so this is coming out from some antenna. So this is your cross section of your pyramidal horn. This is a pyramidal horn antenna. What you can see here, this is your height, this is your width. Okay, so this is a waveguide pyramidal horn antenna. So again, what happens is, once the electric field lines come and impinge onto this, you see that some of these electric field lines walls, because there are two walls. Okay, there is one. So some of the electric field lines which get onto this side wall one, okay, they are short circuited here. Again, some electric field lines which are impinging on to this particular wall, they are again going to be shorted by this wall. Okay, so in what happens is, final outcome is these electric field lines are going to be zero. That means they are not going to be contributing for any kind of a power. That means, because these many electric field lines are going to be shorted, so electric field will be zero along the wall. So even though the physical aperture is equal to length into breadth, so this aperture is receiving the power. Only a small fraction is actually receiving the power. Okay, so we will try to for this aperture. Now, if you look at the same figure, now if I say S is represents the power density or the pointing vector, which is represented in S watts per meter square. AE represents the aperture. A is the aperture, I am saying, okay, which is the physical aperture, is AP. E is the incident electric fields, Okay, when this incident electric field impinges onto the antenna, there is a current which is going to be set up, and correspondingly there is a voltage and current which is going to be set up along this antenna. Now the power received by the antenna is given by P. Okay, so P is equal to S into AE. So almost, so you should always remember that. So the effective power which is going into the antenna is directly proportional to the area of the antenna or the aperture of the antenna. So how much is your aperture? Only depending on that, that many electric field lines are only going to enter into your antenna. Okay, so if I increase the aperture size, the more will be the power received. Okay, so in the sense we can say that power received is given by S into AE, where S is the incident power density, which is watts per meter square. AE is the aperture of the antenna. So here AE is equal to AP, which I am going to consider as physical aperture. So I can write this as AP, S into AP. Okay, where AP is your physical aperture. Okay, which is receiving the power. So again, S is given by pointing vector or power density, which is given by E cross H. S is equal to E cross H. And this is equal to EH sine theta. EH sine theta. So always you should remember that theta is equal to 90 degree, because E and H are perpendicular to each other. So sine 90 will be 1. So S will be equal to EH. And again, you have another relationship between E and H. E and H are going to be related with the intrinsic impedance by this equation. E by H is equal to eta naught. This is equal to 120 pi. So this is equal to approximately 377 ohms. This is E by H. So then what happens is your power received is equal to E square by Z into AP, or I can write it as equal to S into AP, where S is the power density. So this is going to give you the received power in watts. Now another important thing is, as I have told you, this physical aperture AP, okay, is not the one which is going to be contributing for the power. Okay, so you should understand that, as I have told you, there is a power loss which takes place inside the horn antenna, even though this is your horn antenna, okay, which I have shown you. So some of these electric field lines will get shorted along the side of the horn antenna, isn't it? They get short circuited. So when they get short circuited, you see that the electric field lines which are trapped at this corner, or which are going to be trapped at this particular corner of the horn, they are going to be made as zero. So many electric field lines are going to be lost. So your effective aperture will not be equal to AP. In fact, it will be less than AP, which I am going to call it as EAE. In this case, I am going to call it as EAE. Physical aperture which extrudes side walls, and the physical aperture AP. Now we will try to find out an expression for this aperture efficiency. So aperture efficiency is given by the ratio of effective aperture to physical aperture. Okay, and remember, aperture efficiency is a factor which is always between 0.5 to 0.8. Okay, it's always a ratio, it's always a factor. And sometimes what happens is this horn is basically tapered towards the edges, okay, to reduce the side lobes. So normally if you look at the antenna radiation, okay, so the antenna radiation pattern side lobes. So if you look at the horn antenna, this horn antenna is not going to be having the same cross section over the entire length. Okay, so you can see here it is tapered here. Okay, so why this tapering is done is basically to reduce the side lobes. You are going to taper this. Okay, so because of which the efficiency of your horn antenna will be approximately equal to 50 to 80%, because we have taken the horn antenna as our antenna for finding out the antenna efficiency. So in that case, normally if you take any antenna, efficiency will be in the range of 50 to 80%. So antenna aperture efficiency is given by epsilon AP. It is between 0.5 to 0.8. Next is effective aperture. Effective aperture is another important concept. Now let us, to find out the effective aperture, we will try to take an example of a dipole antenna which is going to be terminated in an impedance equal to ZT. Okay, this is your incident voltage wave. So when this incident voltage wave impinges onto this antenna, so we are assuming that this electric field lines are polarized. Okay, when the electric vertically polarized and for vertical polarization, that there is a voltage which is going to be induced inside this, and there will be a current. Okay, that current is given by I. So this is the current which is going to be induced, and this will be flowing along the end length of the. You have a terminating impedance here. Impedance represents the impedance which is actually receiving the power. Okay, and this antenna. This is your antenna part. Okay, this is your transmission line which you see here. Okay, so basically, what happens is you have voltage V, ZA represent the antenna impedance, and again you have got ZT which is your terminating impedance. Okay, so you have all these three things coming in series. You have V, ZA and ZT coming in series, and I represents the current which is going to be flowing in this circuit. Again, the current is given by V by Z, where V, Z is the impedance. Again, Z is given by Z. Okay, given by plus JXT, where RT is the resistive part of the terminating impedance, XT represents the reactive part of the terminating impedance. Similarly, ZA is given by RA plus JXA. RA represents the resistive part of the impedance and XA represents the reactive part of the impedance. Okay, this is associated with the antenna impedance, and ZT is the terminating impedance. And I and V are the voltage, currents and voltages. So normally the terminating antenna impedances are going to be complex in nature. So we can now derive an empirical expression for this aperture. So you have the power which is going to load. So this is your antenna. Okay, so I told you this is your ZT, isn't it? This is your ZT, this is your ZA. And this is your V. So this is the voltage induced, this is ZT, this is ZA. Okay, this is the current which is going to be flowing. All right. This power is going to be dissipated in this tube part of the impedance as ZT as RT and XT. RT resistive part. But it is always RT. So now if you look at it, is going to be finally dissipated in the resistive part of the terminating impedance. So that's why I have written power to RT. Again, current I is equal to V by Z. Okay, V by Z. Again, Z is equal to ZA plus ZT, isn't it? ZA plus ZT. What is ZA? Antenna impedance. What is ZT? Terminating impedance. ZA is equal to RA plus JXA and ZT is equal to RT plus JXT. Find out the impedance value. Magnitude is given by RA plus JXA plus RT plus JXT. And again, this antenna impedance is going to be divided, which is equal to radiation resistance RR, okay, and loss resistance RL. Okay, so normally what happens is this length, whatever you have taken here, okay, this length has got certain loss resistance, which I'm going to call it as RL. And there is a radiation resistance. Okay, it is through this radiation resistance only the effective power is finally going out of the antenna or coming into the antenna. That I'm going to call it as RR. Okay, it's a fictitious resistance. So RR plus RL will be your total antenna resistance. Okay, so if you find out ZA plus ZT magnitude, it comes out to be equal to square root of RA plus RT whole square plus J into XA plus XT. Whole square, because the impedances are in series. So power is again as I have told I square RT. So again I is V by Z. So find out I V by ZA plus JXA. Again, if you find out ZT is RT, again you separate the real terms on one side, imaginary terms on another side, and if you find out the magnitude, you will get RR plus RL plus RT whole square plus XA plus XT whole square. This is the denominator part. So power is equal to I square into RT. Square this, it will be V square RT divided by square root of RR plus RL plus RT whole square plus XA plus XT whole square. This also you have to square it. Okay, if you square this part, what happens is you see that power, the ratio of the power received to the incident power density is given by aperture, where P is the power in termination, S is the power density of the incident wave, A is the area. So again, you have under for maximum power transfer theorem, what you do? You make sure that the resistive part, the antenna, resistive part of the antenna impedance, that is RA, is should be equal to RT. Again, RA is equal to RR plus RL, isn't it? So your RT should be equal to RR plus RL. And another important thing is this XA should be equal to minus XT, okay, which is already shown here. XA should be equal to minus XT. RT should be equal to RR plus RL, because RA is equal to RR plus RL. So in that case, the expression for the aperture reduces to V square into RR plus RL, because V square RT it is. So RT is equal to RR plus RL. So substitute this value of RT here. So this will be V square into RR plus RL divided by S into RR plus RL plus RR plus RL whole square plus XA minus XA whole square. So you look at this. So if you look at this, so finally it comes out to be equal to V square into RR plus RL divided by S into 2 into RR plus RL whole square. So again, RR plus RL, if you expand this, it will be 4 into RR plus RL whole square. So again, RR plus RL, RR plus RL whole square gets cancelled. So finally, the effective aperture comes out to be equal to V square divided by 4S. So effective aperture considers the resistance into account and three parameters. One is the voltage induced, the power density, and the resistances. Okay, again, there are two resistances, RR and RL. Okay, so it is inversely proportional to the resistance, RR and. Now you can understand that if I want to make the antenna lossless, that means under lossless case, then the effective aperture becomes equal to maximum effective aperture if I make RL is equal to zero. Okay, so if RL becomes equal to zero, we obtain the condition for maximum effective aperture, which is given by V square divided by 4S RR. So it is expressed in either meter square or lambda square. So this aperture AEM represents the area over which the power is extracted from the incident wave and is. And last important concept is physical aperture represents the actual antenna. Okay, actual dimension of the antenna. And for a pyramidal horn, it is given your width and this is your height. So it is given by the ratio of the product H into W. So this is. Now let us do some problems. An antenna has a radiation resistance of 73 ohm and a loss resistance of 7 ohm. If the power gain is 20, calculate the directivity and efficiency of the antenna. So there are two things. One is directivity, other is efficiency. I told you antenna efficiency is given by the ratio of AE by AEM. Okay, AE is already known to you, V square divided by 4S RR plus RL. So AEM is again V square divided by 4S RR. So this is equation number 3. So if you take the ratio of AE by AEM, you get V square divided by 4S RR plus RL divided by V square divided by 4S RR. So if you look at this, it is shown here. So some terms gets cancelled here, V square gets cancelled, 4S, 4S gets cancelled. So antenna efficiency is finally RR divided by RR plus RL. So you have been given the values of RR and RL. So substitute that value, you get 73 by 80, which is 0.9125. And another important thing is gain. So gain, you already know it is equal to directivity. Okay, provided antenna efficiency is equal to 1. But antenna efficiency will never be equal to 1. So gain is always given by neta into d, where neta represents the antenna efficiency. This is your antenna efficiency. Okay, so now in antenna efficiency you have just calculated. Okay, it is given by how much? 0.9125. So substitute that value in the expression for gain and try to simplify this equation. Okay, so you get D is equal to G by neta. Directivity is equal to G by neta. Again, G is 20 and neta is 0.9125. You will get directivity as equal to 21.915. This is normal value of directivity expressed in dBs. Take 10 log to the base 10 of this. Okay. 10 log to the base 10 of. So then you are going to get 13.407. This is your directivity in decibels. Okay, so now summarize. So in today's class, we discussed about effective height, which is given by the ratio of the voltage induced to the incident electric field. So if you consider a linear lambda by 2 antenna, okay, which we have seen, the current is not necessarily constant over the entire cross section. So current is maximum at the center and minimum or zero near the ends. So the average current comes out to be equal to 0.64 times the maximum current, because maximum current is having a value equal to 1. So effective height will be normally 0.64 times the physical height, okay, for such a antenna. So the effective height is the cross section of the antenna which is effectively contributing for radiation. Okay, so next is we discussed about, again, apertures are going to be classified into different. One is the physical aperture, which is direct given by the product of the height and the width. So again, effective aperture is going to be found out by using a equation wherein you have V square divided by 4S RR plus. Normally the RR resistance, RL the present resistance, and you are going to find out this condition. Okay, you have taken an example of it, okay, which is going to be a terminating impedance. So under matched condition, you are trying to find out the aperture. Considering the antenna loss resistance, then you are going to call that aperture as effective aperture. And when you make the antenna loss resistance is equal to zero, then whatever aperture you get, that is known as the maximum effective aperture, which is given by V squared divided by 4S RR. So you can now understand the difference between effective aperture and the physical aperture. So then we get the antenna efficiency, which is a very important parameter, which is given by the ratio of these two apertures. That is the effective aperture to the maximum effective aperture. It is given by RR divided by RR plus RL. Then we did some numerical problem to support our stand. So in the next class, we will try to discuss some more important concepts related to antennas. Namely, we will try to find out the maximum effective apertures of dipole antenna, linear lambda by 2 antenna, derive the Friis formula, and find the relationship between gain and directivity, and so many things. So I thank you all for your patient listening. Thank you.